Okay, welcome everybody. Thank you, Kira. Kira is the driving force behind this webinar series, so we owe her a lot for setting all of this up and for hosting the Zoom meetings and so on and so forth. I do want to introduce some people. Hannah Zechman is here. She helps in our office. She's the Assistant State Coordinator for Tennessee History Day. Natalie Sweet is with us. Natalie is our district coordinator in Northeast Tennessee. And then Lisa Oakley is here with us. She's our East Tennessee director. And Janice Perry is with us. She is with our partner organization, the Tennessee State Library and Archives. So all of these people are people who know answers to questions and can help you as you prepare for Tennessee History Day. So I'm going to share my screen. And I want you all to turn off your videos and your microphones because we're going to be watching a video and we have found that it helps with the buffering issues if your all's video is not on. All right, and I'm going to share it with our computer sound. So we'll go ahead and share. Hopefully you all can see that. And if I go here to view, we're going to go ahead and start our PowerPoint. Okay, so welcome. Today we're going to be talking about Tennessee History Day, which is a program sponsored by the Tennessee Historical Society. And the first thing that I'd like to know is how many people, let's see, where'd my little poll go? I thought I had a poll. That's not it. I think maybe I have to actually get out of this. Oh, thank you, Kara. If you can answer this, have you participated in History Day before or not? And this presentation is actually geared more for people who are brand new to History Day. So if you've done History Day before, hopefully you will not be too completely bored and you will learn something. So we'll give it about 20 more seconds. Okay, let's look at the results here. Share results. How do I share the results? Are you sharing the results, Kara?
Yes, I'm sharing the results.
Okay, thank you. All right, so as we can see, about 30% of you have participated before and 70% of you are new to History Day, so that's perfect. So thank you to everybody for joining us. All right, so we have a lot of slides to get through. I kind of was overly ambitious. I'm hopefully going to take about 45 or 50 minutes just for the content to get through this. And then at the end of the presentation, we'll stop the recording and open it up for questions. Okay, next slide. All right, so as I said, the Tennessee History Day is put on by the Tennessee Historical Society. That's not the only thing that we do. We also put out the Tennessee Historical Quarterly, and we organize the Tennessee and host the Tennessee Encyclopedia of History and Culture, which you may have used in your classroom before. I hope that you have used it before. We would love it if you decided to join the Tennessee Historical Society. We have a special offer for teachers of $25. That's for a yearly membership. When we send you your certificate, we'll send you a flyer for that special reduced rate. So today we've had our welcome. We'll talk about what History Day is. We'll talk about the theme for this year, and then we'll go into some details about how we're going to run our contest this year, which will be all virtual. Now, if you have questions, feel free to drop them in the chat. Hannah will bring them to my attention, or she may be able to answer you in the chat itself. Okay, so do introduce yourself in the chat. Tell us your name, your school, where your town is, what subjects you teach. This is how Hannah's going to be taking attendance so that we make sure that we get a certificate for you. At the end of the session, we will be putting in links for the Padlet and for the survey. We'll also have them on the slides as well. And they were also included in your confirmation email. All right, so what is Tennessee History Day? History Day, or Tennessee History Day, is part of National History Day. National History Day is project-based learning where students are actually asked to be historians rather than just memorizing dates or lists of names. They're asked to do their own independent research to create a thesis and then present those ideas to a larger audience. Now, the larger audience might be your classroom. It might be a school competition, a district competition. It might be to people, patrons at the library. It might be to a special documentary night that you host at your school. This was actually made really very real to me yesterday. I was writing a blog entry on Ida B. Wells, and I actually, for myself, used History Day principles for doing research. I went and I looked at the primary sources first, and then after I had formulated a thesis, I consulted the secondary sources. And one reason I did that is because I didn't want to accidentally plagiarize anything. So I was trying really hard to come up with my own words and to put my argument into my voice. And that's what we want the students to do. We're going to take a look at a sample documentary. This documentary was done by Jesse Henderson. This was from the previous academic year. The title is Unwelcome Soldiers Invading a Fraternity, Breaking Gender Barriers in the United States Military. She came in second at Tennessee History Day and then won the Captain Ken Kosky Naval History Prize Special Award at National History Day. The theme for this previous academic year is breaking barriers in history. So this is going to take us about 10 minutes. 10 minutes is the time limit for a documentary. And I hope that we all enjoy this and I'm able to click on the tab without doing, It's annoying when I can't get the tab pulled up. There we go. All right. So if it starts to mess up, we may not be able to see it all, but I have put the link to this in the Padlet so you can use it with your students as well.
Women have been breaking barriers in the United States military since the founding of the country. In those early years, they served as nurses, administrators, and even spies. Some disguised themselves as men in order to serve in the military. Later, they worked as mechanics and pilots. One such woman in recent history was Captain Rosemary Bryant Mariner of the United States Navy. Captain Mariner broke gender barriers in the United States military by surpassing expectations as a naval aviator and achieving many firsts for service women. She became a powerful advocate for military women's rights, opening the doors for equality in combat and other areas. Rosemary Mariner was born as Rosemary Bryant on April 2, 1953 in Texas, to a military family. Her father died in a transport plane crash when Mariner was three. Raised in San Diego, in the shadow of the Miramar Naval Air Station, Mariner grew up watching the planes at the airbase, and she knew she wanted to fly. She drew inspiration from people like Jackie Cochran, the first woman to break the sound barrier, and the WASPs, a group of World War II women who were recruited to test aircraft and train pilots when many men were killed or injured. Mariner was also inspired by the Republic, with Plato's vision of the ideal society in which women participate as soldiers. At age 17, Mariner began to wash airplanes at Gillespie Field in exchange for flying lessons, earning over 700 hours flight time in civilian aircraft. In 1972, while studying aeronautics at Purdue University, her mother sent her a newspaper clipping stating that the Navy would start training female pilots. Graduating college at 19, Mariner, then Knatzer, and seven other women joined the experimental first class. While the press was enthralled by the women, these pioneers faced discrimination from men. Mariner stated, "For the first time in many of our lives, we were disliked by some people solely because of what we were, unwelcome soldiers invading a fraternity." But the women persisted. Mariner recalled,
"The first dealt with that old bugaboo, physical standards. The supposed logic was that if a woman could not do the same number of chin-ups as a man, then women weren't strong enough to fly airplanes."
Captain Joellen Drag Osland, the first female naval helicopter pilot, remarked,
"I had one guy who refused to even pre-flight an airplane with me. You know, he was afraid his wife would get jealous or something like that."
Undeterred, Mariner and five others became the first women certified to fly in the United States Navy in 1974. On July 17th of that year, she was designated a naval aviator. Her first commanding officer was African-American Captain Ray Lambert. Using his own experiences with racial discrimination, he taught her to stand in the face of prejudice. He told her, "The way you're going to survive and do well in this endeavor is to network, talk to people, and mentor others." In the early years of her career, Mariner opened doors by filling positions traditionally held by men. She became the first female pilot to report to Naval Air Station Oceana, a base for the United States Navy's fighter attack jet fleet. She was also the first female military aviator on the East Coast to fly solo in a military jet, as well as the first woman to qualify for the carrier-capable A-7 Corsair II. However, due to the 1948 Women's Armed Services Integration Act, women were still barred from combat vessels and flying at sea. She and others wrote letters asking for aircraft carrier qualification, but they were all ignored. While working at China Lake Naval Weapons Station in 1977, Rosemary met her future spouse, Tommy Mariner. On their first date, Tommy asked, "What's important to you?" She replied, "To be accepted as a person." They married in 1980. Tommy reflected, "I made the decision early on that her career was unique. There was a lot of guys who could do what I did, but her path-forging career was one of a kind at the time." In 1978, another victory was achieved for female aviators. A federal judge ruled banning Navy women from ships unconstitutional. Congress repealed Section 6015 of U.S. Code Title 10. This change allowed them to serve on non-combatant ships. With federal law altered, Mariner broke yet another barrier, becoming the first female jet pilot assigned to an aircraft carrier, the USS Lexington. There was still disapproval, however. Before becoming the Secretary of the Navy, Jim Webb wrote, "It is easy to say these women are pioneers who are breaking barriers, and perhaps they are, but there is a cost, and they, along with society and men, are paying the price." In 1990, during Operation Desert Storm, Mariner was named the first woman to command a squadron, VAQ-34. At the change of command ceremony, Rear Admiral Stephen R. Briggs explained, "Rosemary Mariner is not here today because she is a woman. She is not here today because she is a fine naval aviator. Commander Rosemary Mariner is here simply because her career is marked by distinguished, exemplary performance as a superb naval officer, and she is taking merely the rightful place that that performance has earned her." Over the years, Mariner strongly advocated for women's military rights, striving to educate officials about the issues. She wrote many articles arguing for women's inclusion in combat. She stressed, "If American women are good enough to die for their country, they are good enough to fight." Mariner maintained that limiting women's availability hurt the all-volunteer force and posed other problems. She also declared physical strength not as important as intelligence. She stated, "In modern warfare, the emphasis is not on physical strength, but on brain power operating sophisticated weapon systems. A machine gun is a great equalizer." Others agreed. Representative Patricia Schroeder said, "In other words, because of the Army's combat exclusion policy, women can be the first killed in a battle, but cannot hold a combat job." Gallup survey showed that from 1991 on, the majority of the United States public was in support of women fighting in combat. However, many disagreed. Author George Gilder voiced that women aren't as aggressive as men, and therefore not as suited to war. He stated, "The ancient tradition against the use of women in combat embodies the deepest wisdom of the human race. It expresses the most basic imperatives of group survival." General Robert Barrow, former Commandant, United States Marine Corps, expressed his views by stating,
"Brutality, death, dying, it's uncivilized, and women can't do it, nor should they be even thought of as doing it."
In June 1992, Mariner testified at a presidential commission hearing, sharing her support for women in combat. In a separate congressional hearing, Colonel John W. Ripley countered, "If you think women have a so-to-speak right to grovel in this filth, just because someone above them wants to be promoted, then my God, what has happened to the American character and the classical idea of womanhood?" Colonel Ripley held the position that women would be looked at as victims by the enemy. In 1993, Mariner was promoted to captain. The same year, the Presidential Commission on the Assignment of Women in the Armed Forces recommended that the combat ban remain. However, the Department of Defense changed the policy to allow women in non-direct combat positions.
"The essence of the new policy is that the military services are to open up more specialties and assignments to women. First of all, the services are to allow women to compete for assignments in combat aircraft. Second, the Navy is to open up additional ships to women. Third, I'm instructing the Navy to draft a proposal, which I shall forward to Congress, that would remove the last legislative barrier to the assignment of women to combat vessels.
This opened career advancement opportunities to female aviators and ensured that women had the same opportunities as their male counterparts. While the first combat barrier had been broken, controversy continued. A year later, Lieutenant Kara Holtgreen became the first female combat certified death. Despite the tragedy, the changes from the new policy radiated. Mariner continued to advocate for female integration in ground combat through articles, speeches, and testimonies. These efforts helped bring a 2013 policy change that allowed women into ground combat positions. However, it gave some military installations, such as special forces, a choice. 3 years later, all units changed to include women. A female service member recently described Mariner's impact. Because of your life, your commitment, your tenacity, I have been able to choose to fight for my country in combat. You gave me that choice with your fight. Mariner's last naval assignment was the chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Professor of Military Studies at the National War College. She and her family moved to Tennessee in 1997. She became a lecturer and resident scholar in the Center for the Study of War and Society at the University of Tennessee, Knoxville. Her efforts toward military gender equality were not the only way she impacted lives. To the end of her days, Mariner worked to influence and inspire the people she met. On the last day of her life, her doctor said, "Rosemary, you changed me." She replied, "I know. I meant to." Captain Mariner died on January 24, 2019 of ovarian cancer. Barriers continued to be broken at her funeral when she was honored with the first all-female flyover, the Missing Man Formation.
It's super humbling. If it weren't for Captain Mariner that paved the way for us, then we wouldn't have been able to do what we did today in her honor.
Captain Rosemary Mariner broke gender barriers in the United States military, not only by completing firsts for servicewomen, but also by successfully campaigning for women's combat rights. She achieved her mission of gender military integration and cleared a path for others to soar.
And ultimately, her real goal became not to be exceptional, but to be the first person that opened the door, but left it open for others to follow her through.
Okay, let's get out of this and go back to our webinar. Okay, sorry, it's not letting me switch tabs because it got the menu right over the tab that I need. Come on. Ugh. All right, I'm gonna actually have to stop screen sharing in order to get to the tab that I need to get to, sorry.
Sure, this is one of the most obnoxious things about Zoom. I wish they would fix, is that menu bar is constantly in the way.
Yes, it is. And I wish that there were a way of dragging it to the side or something. All right, so I want to share. Go back to my PowerPoint. There we go. All right, so let's view it. Let's view our presentation. So a lot of times when I show these documentaries like this, people freak out and they think, oh, my students will never be able to do anything like that. My students will never be that advanced. And that is actually not the goal of Tennessee History Day. What I've shown you today is an award-winning documentary that she worked on for months, probably at least 9 months. And so don't get intimidated by what you've seen. I hope actually it's inspiring to you and you say to yourself, oh, I would love for my kids to be able to do documentaries. All right, so History Day is a year-long educational program for students grades 6 through 12 that is project-based. If you are a fourth or fifth grade teacher, you can adapt it for a youth program. We don't actually have any competitions for you to go to, but if you are in the lower grades or the intermediate grades, do let us know and we can try to help you adapt it for your classroom. It's an opportunity for students to learn about a topic that they're interested in. Of course, you can tie it directly to your curriculum standards. And it's an exploration of any topic in the world, national, state, or local history. We call it Tennessee History Day, but it is not limited to Tennessee history topics. So why do History Day? Well, if you participate in History Day, your students will be better behaved, they will do better on their tests, and they will love school. History Day commissioned a study of school districts that were doing History Day, school districts that were not doing History Day, and school districts that started doing History Day. And lo and behold, the results showed a correlation between students who did History Day and a rise in test scores. So if you want access to that information, I can make that available to you. If you're having a hard time convincing your administrator to let you try History Day. I mean, I am exaggerating a little bit when I say it's life-changing, but I can tell you anecdotally that many students have said to me, "Miss Kaur, I still hate history, but I love History Day." And I say, well, that's because you're getting to do your own research. You're getting to actually do History Day instead of just being a passive vessel for it. It is a great interdisciplinary program if you are a co-teacher. History Day teaches higher order thinking skills, and here we have one of our students, and he is showing off his Library of Congress card. You have to be 16 in order to get a card to the Library of Congress, and he happened to turn 16, and this is when we were in Maryland at the National Conference, and he went into Washington, D.C., and he got himself a library card. It does meet whatever the current standards are, whatever's been invented for this particular year. So students participate by doing the project, and then their project is eligible to compete. They are divided into middle school and high school divisions. So normally, let's say you have your entire eighth grade compete, you would have a school competition. And out of that, you would have your winners, and your winners would go on perhaps to the district contest. And then from the district contest to the regional contest, there's another step in there, from the regional contest to the state contest, and from the state contest to the national contest. So it is a tiered competition. We have five categories, and what I encourage people to do is to have the students do the research and then decide what category that most suits the research that they have done. So maybe you have a student who's done a project on Walt Disney. Well, documentary is a natural fit for Walt Disney because you're going to have good video clips to include in that documentary. Maybe you've done a project on Agnes DeMille, the choreographer. Well, then the performance category might be a good fit because then you could actually show the type of choreography that she created. Students can work individually or in groups of up to five. The research paper is the exception that is limited to one person only. And obviously this year with social distancing, we will have issues with working in groups, and we have tried to come up with ways to help you on that so that students can collaborate virtually. So you can still have group projects this year. Each project is accompanied by, I think I accidentally hit play instead of, there we go. Each project is accompanied by a process paper and an annotated bibliography. This is what the judges usually look at first. The process paper describes the story of how the students did their research, what sparked their interest, what was their most useful primary source, how they went about refining their thesis, and what conclusions they came to. The bibliography is divided into primary and secondary sources, and it is annotated. So currently, documentary and exhibit are the most popular categories. This year with exhibit, since we are going all virtual, those students who've done History Day before, who have done History Day because they love to cut things out and glue things down, and they love that real tactile experience, we are recommending that they start their exhibit in a virtual environment. And the same with performance. Since it's going to be virtual this year, students who have done it before are going to miss out on some aspects of the performance category. We are asking that the students record themselves and submit the recording of the performance. each project should have a clear thesis, and you might want to practice with them how to sit. Well, we're not going to have interviews this year because we can't figure out how to do it. So if they are doing websites, they need to start them or create them in NHD Web Central. That is a proprietary platform that NHD has commissioned and created. And what that does is it levels the playing field. All students have access to the same bells and whistles within NHD Web Central. Okay, come on. Across the state of Tennessee, we have about 7,400 students competing. At our district and regional level, about 1,100 students. At the state level, usually between 250 and 300 students. And this year, for the national contest, we submitted the work of 69 students. Every year there's a theme. These are some of the logos from previous year's themes, and the project and the thesis must connect to the History Day theme. The theme for this year, or the theme, is always chosen so that it is very broad, that's on purpose, and that it can be relevant to any topic from any time period. This is a way of focusing the students' energies toward a particular subject or toward a way of viewing a particular topic. The theme this year is communication in history, the key to understanding. And so what you might want to do when you're brainstorming is you might want to start with the theme and ask the students what kind of topics in history that we've studied relate to this theme. And so some of them might say Alexander Graham Bell and the telegraph, or the invention of the internet. Let them run with those ideas, but know that we're gonna get a lot of projects about Alexander Graham Bell this year. So one thing that you wanna do is define what communication is, how words, thoughts, or ideas are exchanged. It is an action, it's a verb. To communicate. It's something that happens among people, or among people and animals, or among little critters. Amoebas communicate with one another. Probably gonna wanna stick with human activity for this particular project. Communication can be spoken, written, signed, or seen. If you think about protest signs, if you think about American Sign Language, think about the printing press. All of these things have to do with communication. Communication relies upon understanding information, but something that often happens is a misunderstanding and misinformation being conveyed. So maybe that's a way of approaching this particular theme, is what's a good example of a misunderstanding in history? What about the Bay of Pigs? How close did the United States come to engaging in conflict with the Soviet Union over what was misinformation, basically? And these were some examples I saw of the communication loop. I think it'd be helpful to share this with your students because they also need to understand this as well. With their project, they are the sender and they are sending their information out into the world, represented by the judges. The judges need to understand what they're trying to say about their particular topic, and the judges give them feedback. That's one thing about History Day that I really like, that I think distinguishes it as a competition, is that at each stage of the process, the students are provided with feedback from experts in the field and are allowed to revise their projects. Okay, so we're not gonna really get into detail into each of the categories, but I do want you to know that we are going to have additional webinars where we dive into each different category. And we will be going over the changes that are necessitated by this being a virtual contest this year and how you need to plan for that. So our first one is going to be our performance category, which we will have this time next week. So you don't have to register, but if you do, then that'll allow us to have contact with you better. And we will make sure that you have the links to this before the webinar is over. A performance is limited to 10 minutes in length. And again, it can be individual or it can be in groups of up to five. And so the students this year are going to be asked to film themselves. Obviously, for an individual student, you set up some sort of camera on a tripod and the student does the performance and then you submit that recording. For students who are in groups, they can use some sort of platform like Zoom or Google Chat, or there's at least five different platforms that they can use if they cannot meet in person with one another. Now, if they can meet in person, that is fine as well. Exhibit. Again, these are three-dimensional exhibits. This is what exhibits have traditionally been like. This year, we're encouraging you to start the life of the exhibit digitally. Now, if you have a student and the only way that they are going to do a History Day project and the only way they're going to do it is if they get to do an exhibit where they cut everything out and glue it onto a board, that's fine. They can do that. They're just going to need to photograph it and submit those photographs because there's no way we can collect a complete exhibit from them and get it to the judges. The webinar for this is going to be Tuesday, September 22nd. The paper category, there is a change in the rules this year. This year, the paper category also requires a process paper. So the students will get the chance to spend about 500 words talking about themselves and their own interest in the topic. The webinar for that is going to be Tuesday, September 29th. The documentary category, there's not very many changes to that this year. Documentaries are limited to 10 minutes in length. And the documentary webinar will be Tuesday, October 6th. And then the website, that's going to be the easiest one to do this year because it can all be done online and all the collaboration can be done online as well. There are no real changes to this website other than improvements that have been made on the platform in HD Web Central, which I have been assured is easier to use this year than it was last year. And the webinar for that is Tuesday, October 20th. So how do you actually do this? Some people make it a required classroom project. Some people make it a semester-long project, so it takes the place of a term paper or of a major grade or a major test. You can do it with your entire class, your entire 8th grade, your entire 11th grade, or working just with small groups. We've had many teachers who've been very successful with having it as an extracurricular program, an after-school or before-school program. Some schools use it only for their gifted students. I usually say, go ahead and let everybody do it because you might actually discover somebody's gifted because of how they go about approaching History Day. And you can do it individually or it works very well with a team teaching approach. One thing you definitely want to do is get your school librarian on board with History Day because you're going to need that person's help. So this year, you might want to, if you're just starting with History Day, what I've been telling people is everything this year is topsy-turvy. We have no idea what's going on. We have no idea if we're going to be in a classroom next week or if we're going to be sent home. We have no idea if we go home for fall break, if we never come back. So my advice to you is just do what you want. If you've always wanted to try History Day and you've never been able to because of restrictions that you felt placed on you by the curriculum standards or by testing, just go ahead and do it. I mean, nobody can blame you for trying something new this year. I think it might actually help you structure your activities and might be more engaging for the students than just as, you know, what you've been doing all along. Although I'm sure you're all wonderful teachers and wonderfully fascinating and engaging at all times. But you might want to consider limiting categories. If you are a language arts teacher, you might want to stick with the paper. If you are a drama teacher, you might want to stick with performance. If you're a technology teacher, you might want to stick with website and documentary. You might want to limit the topics and tie them directly to your standards. One thing that you might want to think about is group size can tend to be unwieldy. It's a rare group where we have five kids who all still like each other after 9 months together. It has happened. We have had students. We had a group that did very well at National History Day, a group of five kids, and their teacher told me they never argued with one another once. And that is possible. But this year, if you're managing grading group projects, you might want to say, okay, you can work individually or you can work in pairs. And then the contest can be an optional component. If you are having a whole bunch of kids do it, you as the teacher are limited in how many you can bring to your district or regional contest. So you will want to check those limits. They vary from contest to contest. And the reason we instituted those limits on categories is because we had one teacher show up one year with 22 junior group exhibits, which ended up being something like 76 kids. I don't want you, I mean, you can do all exhibits, that's fine, but you only need to bring three of them to the contest. So think about that when you are making the contest component or not, and when you're suggesting what categories your students participate in. We have two websites, our History Day website and our NHD website, have lots of information on them. I'm going to be putting more direct links to the pages that I mentioned on the Padlet. So you don't need to write anything down. These Google Slides will also be part of the Padlet as well, so you'll be able to look at them again. All right, National History Day, starting in the spring, did seven webinars called Teaching History Virtually. And these are very useful. It's not just applicable to the History Day program. You can use the tips and the resources here for what you usually teach. And if you take anything away from this webinar, I would hope it would be that there's these seven webinars available to you. I watched them all, I learned from them, and I think that they're just a great resource to have out there. And the way that you get to them is nhd.org/THV. On that page are all the slides and all the recordings for those webinars, as well as anything, any handouts or something associated with the particular webinar. A shorter one where we talked about virtual strategies. This lasted about an hour. It has concluded, but the recording is available on our website. All right, so we have a virtual contest this year. So that means that everything is due by the deadline. So the deadlines that you see there, the projects must be done. We have two district contests in Northeast Tennessee, and then our regional contests are all across the state. The district contest deadline is Friday, October 30th. That means you have to have something to turn in. Now, I will say that the district contests don't have as many students in them. You can turn something in, and I'm not gonna say don't have it be unfinished, but it doesn't have to be perfect in order to move on to the regional contest. The regional contest deadline for the students and their projects is Monday, February 1st, and all projects must be done and submitted within the registration system. This is a change from last year. This is what we have to do because the contest has gone virtual. On our History Day website, we have our Getting Started page, and this has the new rule book. It has the theme book for this year. It has some graphic organizers for approaching how to think about the theme. The best thing you can do for yourself if you're thinking about doing History Day is to read the rule book. Sit down, read it cover to cover. And then when you have a question about it, go back and read about that particular category again. On here, you'll see the last little tab there says request curriculum packet. feel free, if you want hard copies of everything, to fill out that little survey there, and we will be happy to mail you a hard copy of the rule book, a hard copy of the theme book, and the other materials that we have available for you. All right, so here again, just a reminder, we're going to go into more depth into each of the categories starting next week. We'll have five of them. You'll notice there's a gap there. That's because we have another Discover Tennessee History webinar between these two categories there. We are also going to start having open houses. These are just drop-in times. They'll be for an hour on Tuesday starting November 3rd. We'll have five of them leading up to the teacher registration deadline. And so you can just come and talk to us and ask us, you know, is this a good topic? Does this thesis need more work? This is for teachers, for students, and for family members. So any question that you have, or I thought I created an account for myself and I can't find it, can you look and see if my registration is complete? Any question that you have about the process of competing or about the project itself is open for discussion. So, as I've said, all contests will be virtual at the district, regional, and state level. We do not yet know about National History Day. They've assured me that they will be making the decision in early 2021. As soon as I know, I will let you know. Now, I will tell you, I have a strong suspicion that it will be a virtual contest. I just don't see how it can be in person, because it brings in 3,000 kids from around the world. They stay in dorms and all their families and teachers and coordinators. I mean, it ends up being 6,000 people in one place. And who knows, maybe it can happen, but I don't think it's gonna happen. Okay, so let's talk about the actual contests. You to look and find your county where you are, and if you will notice, we have a purple region and a gray region. These are our district contests. These are held at Tusculum College in Greenville and Lincoln Memorial University in Harrogate. These are earlier. These are in the fall. So if you live in these counties, you have to go to a district contest first, and you have to place at that district contest. And then you get to go to the regional contest, which is held in Knoxville in the spring. So our regional contests are held in Knoxville, Cleveland, Nashville, Murfreesboro, and Memphis, except they aren't going to be held there this year. They're going to be virtual. But that is who is organizing it. That's who your coordinators are. The state contest is usually held in Nashville in the state complex. So we've talked about how if you're in the Northeast, you have to go to a district contest before qualifying for the regional contest. And we've talked about the limits on entries. So you do have to have both the teacher and the student register online using our system in order to participate at any of these contests. All right, so the district contests, these are just those counties in Northeast Tennessee. We open registration for them Friday, October 2nd, and the deadline is Friday, October 30th. That's when you submit what you want to be judged on. For the regional contests, we open registration December 1st. You, the teacher, have to be in the system by January 19th. This is the day after Martin Luther King Day. We want you in the system so that we can communicate with you, so that we know that you're planning on sending students or sending their projects. The deadline for students is Monday, February 1st, and this is everything. This is all categories turning in everything that you want to be judged on. All right, so in Northeast Tennessee, these are the counties involved. Your coordinator is Peter Knoll, and the contest itself will be Friday, November 20th. In Northeast Tennessee District 2, this is Natalie Sweet is your coordinator. She's part of our group here today. And if you live in these counties, if your school is in these counties, this is where you go to start your History Day journey. In East Tennessee, Lisa Oakley, who's with us today on the webinar, is your coordinator. And we've not yet decided the date for that particular contest. In Southeast Tennessee, your coordinator is Allie Thomas. Your contest is going to be Thursday, February 25th. North Middle Tennessee, you have two coordinators, Keisha Brown and Andrea Ringer. And your contest is going to be Friday, February 19th. Middle Tennessee, you also have coordinators, Andy Polk and Molly Taylor Pileski. And your contest is Saturday, February 27th. West Tennessee, your coordinators are Susan O'Donovan and Danielle Clark. Your contest is Saturday, February 27th. All of this information, by the way, is on our website under important dates. It is also on the district or the region's specific web page with the contact info. And the state contest, the deadline for that will be Friday, March 19th, and the state contest will be Saturday, April 10th. The national contest, presumably the second week in June, and hopefully at the University of Maryland in College Park. Okay, so here we have some kids. Maybe we'll get to do that this year, maybe we won't, but this is what they look like when they're there. You can see they're very happy, very excited to be there. Now, we have a Padlet. Hannah is going to put the link in the chat for you. It's going to have the rule book. It will have the theme book. It will have these Google Slides. It will have the video that we watched. It will have anything that I can possibly think of that will help you get started on History Day. We also have a survey that we would like you to take. Hannah is going to put that information in the chat as well. And then coming up, you won't want to miss our other webinars. It'll be the second Tuesday of every month between now and March. And so we have our partner organizations here. And our next one is going to be, Natalie is going to be talking about the Lincolnites. And she is with the Abraham Lincoln Library and Museum. And there's our contact info as well. Again, this is readily available information. You should have gotten a confirmation email from us that has this information in it. So you don't need to write all this stuff down. Okay, I am going to stop my screen share here. Okay, and we have, Kira, if you want to stop the recording, then we have a few minutes to take questions from people.